Welcome everyone. Sounds like an interesting, fun panel. We've got pretty much almost every media represented here, except radio, because no one cares about it, which is a joke. We have Dainik Jagran. It's fine, guys. Calm down. I also do stand up on the side, so occasionally I diffuse tension with jokes. You can laugh. It's fine. Let's sort of begin. I mean, everyone here was initially supposed to, talk a little bit about their own brand, about themselves, introduce themselves. But because of lack of time, we're straight away getting into the panel discussion. Now, the first question I sort of, and I'm okay, whoever wants to say, hey, Khyati, and answer, that's going to work. The first question I sort of want to ask is, this common misnotion that digital is short attention span, the youth is all dumb, and that they don't watch things that are long format, they don't understand content, so everything needs to be this like 2 second, 3 second clickable, logo pehle aana chahiye type situations. How are we adapting to that as as brands? Also, we have Rahul, who's from an agency, who shares my pain. So just curiously, as clients and as marketers and as fellow content creators, how are we dealing with this problem individually? This sort of would be nice because it'll also help you segue into what you guys want to talk about.
Sure, I'll probably go first. Hi, Khyati, by the way. I mean, as a brand that is purely built on digital in India, a lot of the things that you say, in a sense, don't hold true. And I think the millennials today are far more evolved and they're looking for like interesting stuff. But I think they're a tough consumer. They're saying that make it worth my while. Talk about causes and things that resonate with me. Make it interesting for me, and only if you do all of that will I stay with you. So yes, brands certainly need to work harder. It's about putting meaningful, relevant, on-trend content out there, and also providing something that will, you know, really connect with them. Having said that, we all know that brands are not only built by advertising. It's what you offer, offline in terms of your stores or your products, and it is a whole package that has to really come together.
I just wanted to point out some numbers in this. So one of the brands in our portfolio is MTV. And if I look at 15 to 21, which would qualify as young people, they watch around 3.5 hours of TV a day, right? So their screen time might be much more, but 3.5 hours, which is the biggest chunk, is let's say TV. Then you would have on an average 15, 20 minutes of YouTube. You might have around 12 minutes of Facebook. You might have around 9 minutes of Instagram and so on. So it's a decreasing order, maybe around 9-10 minutes of TikTok as well. What has happened is that these are different consumption occasions. So there are lean back occasions where I might watch long format at home or when I have a longer period of time at hand. But earlier the shorter moments, which were empty moments, which is let's say you are sitting in the bus but you're staring out with nothing to do and so on. Or you're taking a break in office, normally you might smoke a cigarette only. These are smaller consumption occasions where you might have space for a 3 or 5 minute piece of content. So content is being consumed as per occasion. So there is a market for everything. There is a market for the 1 hour episode. There is a market for the 40 minute TV series. There's a market for 20 minutes. There's a market for 3 minutes. A lot of the new creators are in the market for 3 minutes and below. And that's the reason why the dominant discourse ends up being these people have attention deficit disorders and so on. But it's just that there's a plethora of content in that space and they're fitting in very neatly into these small stolen moments that consumers have. So I don't think there's any attention deficit disorder. It's more a horses for courses. I'm a strong believer that marketeers who are trying to make 60 seconders and then forcibly cut 2, 3, 4 seconders are not doing this the right way. If you're saying I'm going to target a young person when he's on a 3 minute content consumption break, yes, you can't serve him a 3 minute video when he's about to consume a 3 minute piece of content. That's where you need to have something, but you need to build it for that. You need to build it for a 10, 15 second attention smash and grab sort of approach.
So just to add a different perspective, Legno is basically B2B, so we are not less on the B2C side. I think whatever the medium, whatever is the short span for us, since there are so many stakeholders, it's just not the end consumers, the consistency of what is the content becomes very, very important. You can slice and dice the content in various medium which you choose. And from a strategy purpose, it becomes very important that we look at a medium consistency to be relevant with your target audience. And we feel very strongly that whatever we communicate needs to have a strategic fit. Just to give you an example, if we say Legrand is an innovative company, there is a KPI which says that your product catalog should be less than 5 years old. Then only you will be relevant midterm. If there's a strategic objective that, okay, I'm an innovative company, my products would be less than 5 years old, then the communication team really have this confidence, okay, here is a midterm strategy, and then you choose your medium, slice and dice, put whatever creativity you want to put in 2 seconds, 30 seconds, in whichever digital means to communicate. But I think the consistency and, like she said, what to promise the brand offers needs to be really backed up by a solid strategy to create this content.
Yeah, I think excellent points. So I actually resonate to the pain that you're talking about. As a creative head of the agency so the biggest difference that has happened is that today for a marketer or for a brand, these mediums are free. And when I say free, they are at liberty that I can right now go and post something right after this and there's nobody actually holding me back. Gone are the days when I had to actually pay to put anything up anywhere, right? So the challenge remains is that there's a huge greed for brands to do a lot of things, whether it comes down to the number of posts or the number of stuff that one is putting out there. As creators, we have to constantly be very aware of, it's like small drops which make up a big ocean, right? And what is it that it all adds up to? I think at a larger perspective, it will be very foolish to say that, okay, it's a 3 second, 5 second thing, and it is all about the amount of quantity that I put out. So I am actually, making him very happy. That's not true. Subconsciously or consciously, the consumer today, whether it's the young guy, it does add up to a very specific one-line reason that what is the relationship of this brand with me. So people will have to be, we as creators, the brands that we work for, we have to be very, very conscious of that. And we are risking a lot with this whole space of, there is already so much out there, and it's very important that it's not about the amount of stuff that we do or whether it is a 3 second, 5 second, 10 second, which what does that all lead up to, you know? So that's my point, and that's something that we try to do on a daily basis.
You know, what I have experienced is we have various categories, mainly into Unity, and we have various formats as such. But I have seen, as far as our digital strategy is concerned, I don't think that, people have less time. If you have interesting, content, I think people, watch it. They fully devote their time. And I don't think, I think it is more interest. If you create a, interesting content, people will watch it.
Yeah, so in my perspective, and we are a media company in print, digital, radio, outdoor, and we are touching almost 24 crore people pan-India, small cities, big cities, metros. I think we think of at least thinking that this entire country is segmented into three countries. One, a 20 crore layer, another a 60 crore layer of people, and another 50 crore who are really not having that level of an access of media, digital information.
And then there's the government and the ministers.
yes, you said it. So when we think of the 60 crore and when we think of this 20 crore, the first two I'm talking about, I think the consumption patterns also change. I mean, and I'm talking about millennials and I'm talking about those who are globally connected, and we see them as one audience. I mean, within country also, we see them in one audience. But I think this changes. The second one turns out to be from the point of view of the fundamental values. Like, for instance, I would know of that the people who I have closely observed would subliminally know everything without reading a newspaper for even 3 minutes. And God knows where the consumption is happening. And it is also, of course, on digital medium. But beyond that, what is not coming on digital and which is very local in nature, the consumption of information is happening. But it's happening at a very subliminal level. Apparently, it looks like, oh, I don't give a damn. I'm not worried about it. So which means that there is a different processing mechanism of us being consciously reading something or viewing something and processing it versus it turning out to be that I think I know it, but it's just this much which I need to know right now at this moment. So nothing beyond that. So I think long and short is probably not significant. The way you segment the geography as well as the way you look at the way you are able to evoke interest, which is what most of the panelists have stated, make a difference.
And also I just wanted to, you know, add that, you know, whenever somebody start thinking about, you know, I want to go, you know, digital, I want to spend my resources on digital, first thing, you know, that I think, you know, why only digital? I mean, have I not explored, you know, other mediums as such, TV, press, those are quite a relevant medium even today. You know, it's not only digital. Yes, you must have some sort of a strategy to go digital, but it is still a medium. That's, you know, I think we should keep it in mind.
So that's an interesting point. I'm just going to freewheel with questions from there, because what's an interesting point is while Naveen is saying that there is a huge consumption of hour-long formats of TV, which break this myth and stereotype that sort of exists, right? And I agree that it's not an attention deficit disorder. It's and it's gratifying to hear marketers say that as well. What I think the question therefore is, in a day like today, MTV still holds relevance within the 15 to 21. Except the 15 to 21 just every 7 years moves up, and then you have a new 15 to 21. Now when it looks at when you're talking about Dainik Jagran, as a brand, it has pedigree, it has history, but it's predominantly as a brand. I'm not saying the other stuff that you're doing, but as a brand, it is considered to be an old fuddy-duddy sort of, you know, brand. So how do you move, whereas Starbucks doesn't have that problem today, 40 years from now, who knows, but currently it does not have that problem. Same with, say, you know, when you're looking at Legrand, how do you, I mean, the decision maker is not the youth in a situation like you. Whereas when Vaag Bakri happens, there's a very focused market where you're actually present, predominant. And over there also, it's almost like familial. Ki ye ghar mein aata hai, toh ghar mein aata hai situation, right? And then for us, in terms of from an agency standpoint. So I'm just trying to figure out what innovations are you doing? Are you launching other platforms, keeping away the Dainik Jagran name? Is Vaag Bakri going to open up cafes, which you are? Are you opening up tea sellers, etc.? Because Starbucks and MTV doesn't seem to have that problem. But what is how Starbucks might have another problem, which is how do you pull in people to the store on a regular basis and move away from Swiggy deliveries? You know, and that's what you're saying. All my Starbucks is delivered through Swiggy, but and I'm your biggest customer. But I'm saying, and MTV, how do you redefine? How is it that you're going about looking at? Oh, there's a new 7 year, you know, bundle that we have to worry about. And how do we have? And this is the problem I face on Gems. So I would really appreciate this insight and then think. So it's another interesting way to sort of look at how we're staying relevant despite our various images that we have. So this is going to take another 10 minutes, so I can give the mic to Naveen.
So what you stated immediately in context of Dainik Jagran, some 13 years earlier, we were to understand that the language has changed. I mean, the typical journalistic language in print, and I'm talking of regional, is very, you know, it's almost like how Salma Sultan would read the Doordarshan news then versus, you know, the formats which came in after Aaj Tak got introduced and consistently Arun Puri was stating, let's change the language, simple banao, easy karo, and which was a mix of lingo. The print and also went through a mix of lingo. So 13 years earlier, Jagran realized that we are the largest for the last some 20 years consistently, and this is like by far bigger. But this is the audience with which we are not communicating what we intend to communicate. So we took this liberty and we said we will write the spoken language. So we created a daily just for the cities. We identified the TG, which was a younger TG, the same news being carried in absolutely different language. We were criticized initially for this. We were said, how can you, you know, take away the sanctity of Hindi or the language? But we were to change, and we realized that suddenly we were connected with several of them in schools and colleges, other chunk of in places, who were saying, it's simple, hai, mere tarah ki baat karta hai. Small, small experiments of changing a long copy to small subheads. Copy still remains long, but subheads, another chunk of anything. So I think the relevance is carry the same value. Change the way the communication or conversation is happening in a very modern, contextual manner. That's what our experience has been.
Okay, I just wanted to share what I remember as a global example as the difference between, so just indulge me for a bit, the difference between Kodak and Fujifilm, why Kodak died and Fujifilm survived. That was because Kodak, from a consumer lens, was in the business of capturing priceless memories. But from Kodak's perspective, they thought they were in the business of patented filmmaking technology. So it is a fact that in 1975, Kodak made the first digital camera. But the conversation was, but we are in the business of filmmaking. If we start selling digital cameras, this whole business that we've set up, where there's a huge entry barrier of technology, which is the film business, is going to go bust. So let's not give this any wind. But 25 years from then, 2001, is when they peaked in terms of their business on films. And from then on, it's been a steep fall and they've shut down. The exact same trajectory happened with Fujifilm. But Fujifilm, once they figured out that they were getting behind the curve, they said, what do we have or what do we stand for? And they figured out, again, it's technology and it's possibly not such a differentiated brand. And then they scavenged on pieces of those technologies, like they picked up one piece which was critical to LCD making. So on that component, they currently have 70% share of LCDs. And they metamorphed into a non-consumer B2B sort of company. And therein lies, in my head, part of the story, which is, if you're not connected to your consumer all the time, and you're not looking at it from a consumer lens, but from your business lens, saying, what do I have, what are the resources I have, and how do I sell this, then you're likely to become one of the non-evergreen brands. Coming to MTV, what we do is, every 2 years, we poll around 25,000 young people across the country. And we try and publish that in the public domain as well to try and share the information. And we use those insights to try and drive our thinking. So let's say 4 years back, we realized that the whole market any which way was moving to convenience. Now, OTT is not a separate consumer. It's a consumer who's saying, I need to watch content when I want it. Is when Viacom 18 put out Woot, saying all the stuff we show on TV, whether it's Colors or MTV or any of our channels, you can watch it at your convenience. So it's a convenience platform more than a very different offering. Of course, there will be some Woot originals, but it's a convenience piece. So when you're alive to, let's say, a shift in consumption behavior like that, you can tend to stay relevant. And the insight study, so for example, this year or last year when we put out the study, the defining piece we found for young people now is the fact that they are action-oriented. More than any other generation, more than the clicktivist and Facebook cribbers, they have decided that this is, we will have to do it ourselves. So this feeling of we will have to do it ourselves and we'll have to make the change happen is what's the most defining piece. And this study predates the CAA protests and students and so on. So the writing was on the wall for us even back then. And we've tried to use, let's say, some of these insights into our programs. So Roadies, for example, is an old 15-year-old show. But this season, because we know young people are looking at action orientation for themselves, the show will be about how young people not just physically and mentally challenge each other, it's about how do you bring greater good to society. So if they're driving through, let's say, a town which has a broken school, the task will be to fix the school. And in doing that, I come back to the same point, which is, where is your consumer headed and are you looking at it through a consumer lens, unlike Kodak? Are you looking at your consumers very, very closely and spending a lot of time looking at consumers is likely to be the key to an evergreen brand.
Just to take forward the Kodak Fuji thing, which is relevant to our business, on the technology side is home automation. We have been in home automation. It's a different technological platform, say 10 years, and now the IoT came in. IoT is a much as abused word. Everything today is IoT. But you have to find a perspective like Fuji did, what in IoT Legrand wants to do. And then once that's defined, and from a consumer perspective, not from your business model perspective, then you really fix on what is the IoT I want to do. And then you start communicating according to that prospect. That's one part of the business side. The other, we are saying what other mediums we use. Clearly, we have experience centers. It's a feel and look of your products. But I think from a digital side, AR and VR are coming very, very strongly. So we have shops and shops or exclusive showrooms. But to make it digital, you do a 360-degree thing, and then you do a AR. I think that technology, especially into B2B, is really, I think, innovative plus cost-effective. You can't have real estates all over the place and demonstrate your product. So that's one side part of it. The other on the medium is we are such a serious business of current, ampere, ohms. To make it fun, we are using comic stunts. So comic is one thing which is very, very old fashioned, but how do you do it in a digital way to get relevant into B2B space from a B2C millennials or whatever you call it. So some innovative things are developed, but clearly the business strategy from a consumer perspective is the key as to what we want to do.
So. I mean, the question is obviously how do you stay relevant over a period of time? So I think it starts with a vision. So the vision for Starbucks as a brand is that you inspire and nurture the human spirit, one cup, one person, one neighborhood at a time. And when it becomes as granular as that, you have to really think about it from that point of view. I'd probably say that it's a journey, right, when you're managing a brand. And I'd maybe take a slightly simplistic approach, which is simplistic in principle but difficult to do in practice, which is to say that managing brands is like managing relationships. And I have a simple acronym for that, which is LOVE. It's about build on your loyalty, constantly create moments that will build on loyalty and reward loyal customers. Shout out, recognize them separately and reward loyal customers. The O is really for being on trend, and different brands can interpret this differently. For a brand like Starbucks, it's very important to be slightly ahead of the curve and not follow trend. V is the vision. So how do you stay true to your vision every single interaction and evaluate all the activities that you do from the point of view of are they elevating your vision? Are they taking your vision to another level? And the most important thing is experiences. The E really stands for experiences. A brand like Starbucks is highly experiential. And you know, a lot of customers come and tell us that they come to Starbucks for the coffee, but they stay for the inviting warmth. They get a sense of being recognized when they walk into a Starbucks. The barista knows their name. He or she will smile at them. And they just feel seen and heard. And we talked about digital before this. But interestingly, in an increasingly digital world, you're also living in a more lonely world. So how do you make that human connection count at every point in your offline as well as your online interactions? Even through your online interactions, you can create that connection. So to my mind, it is really about how do you really create that love in everything that you do, stay very close to your consumer, and look at everything as an experience rather than a transaction.
Someone's just changed the clock, so I'm just going to point that out. Yeah. Just so you know. 19% of first Tinder dates happen at Starbucks.
Yeah.
Which is a great statistic. Because you all shot at 9. Rahul and...
Why do you get to ask us questions and you do go again? So I have a question for you. So.
Yeah. It doesn't work like this, huh? I am Arnav in this situation.
I am a partner for
okay, fine. Let's
I'm
go.
In the same place. So sure. I can do that.
Let's do
so,
this.
So what do you think about Alia Bhatt dancing to Vajradanti, Vajradanti, Viko Vajradanti?
What do I think about it?
Yeah.
It really, really, really disrupted my experience of Parasite.
I'm with you, brother, on that.
No, I mean I understand the shift on the brand. I don't know what the strat is, what the creative is, what it is. But I understand the shift on the brand. I mean, you've seen green screen, bad glass, top shot, 1984 product window. You know, that you've seen for damn long. So suddenly when you see it in its refreshing light, there is a switch. Now, do you talk about modernizing the jingle? That's a conversation you need to have, right? Like if you are going to still stick with your own brand identity, which is the jingle. Do you modernize it? Do you not modernize it? Do you come? It's a conversation. So if I had done it, would I do it differently? Yeah. But then that's a virtue of creative and how people work. You still haven't answered the question, but we're going to go to Yogi and then I will come back to you. Huh. Sorry.
So as far as, Vaag Bakri's concern, how we, you know, we are also observing, you know, the consumer. Consumer is changing. You know, in, you know, Indian context, generally, you know, when we have, you know, food, we sit together, have food. But you observe that, you know, the food that we are, you know, eating, you know, initially, you know, in earlier days, we used to have same food. Now we are sitting together, but eating different, different food. Same time, say, you know, same thing, even in tea, you know, it's a tea time and you are having different, different teas. Somebody is having masala tea, somebody is having green tea. So we thought of, you know, we actually pioneered tea lounges, you know, and we have now multiple tea lounges across, you know, India now. So there also we have, you know, this, you know, try our teas, you know, enjoy, and if you like, you know, you can also buy it, okay? And this is how, you know, people have first, you know, started, you know, understanding, oh, and not only that, you know, we have glorified tea as such, but in a way, it also helped, you know, Vaag Bakri as a brand, you know, to in grow in that particular region. People started looking it as, you know, oh, that's a tea brand which is, you know, coming up with tea lounges. It helped us that way.
Okay. This one's slightly left field in the sense that just what's interesting is we spoke about like people being action oriented and the MTV insight study. I mean, I worked at MTV, so I know what the insight study means really. And it's in some way one of the most comprehensive youth studies simply because of the number of people that they reach out to, right? Now, if let's say when you say that they're action oriented, is there, and one of the biggest problems, I mean, we have 199 problems in this country. But I'm just saying, where is activism? Where is purpose? Someone earlier spoke about saying that you need to be relevant with them, create content that's relevant for them, maybe even inspire them. So what is it that we're doing as, I want to say individually as companies, of course, but also collectively as marketers to try and, you know, push this, hey, we're in it for the purpose of it. Or we're in it for the good of it. What is the sustainable, equivalence that we're doing? For example, Guardian said that we're not going to publish more papers than we subscribe. And so if you want to subscribe to the Guardian, then you need to subscribe. Otherwise, you will not get a subscription. Also, great way to collect a database. But that's one way that they sort of, did. So they don't have wastage of the Guardian. Starbucks keeps moving into more and more environment-friendly ways to sort of, you know, disposable cups. Okay, no straws, no plus. Some of it is driven by regulation, yes. But I think instinctively we think that there is a recyclable quality to everything that we do. So that's just from an environment standpoint. A lot of brands, of course, extremely scared to delve into the politics of it. At the 2014, I was at MTV and I did Rock the Vote. We had enough legal saying nay 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 to almost everything we put out. So how are we, if we were supposed to get into this political game? And why are we so scared? Is it just ramifications on the company because we're all parts of big conglomerates? Or is it that, what is the action? What is the end goal? And how do we stay relevant with not just young people, but our consumers? So I'm not going to just say young people, but our consumers.
So if you look at it from a sustainability, and I was just picking up that thought and relevance, I think this is very, very consciously there in the mind of everyone now. You know, and I'm talking about the cities. I mean, recently it was told that the top most 30 dirty cities, 21 are from India. Within that, we are doing this Swachhata Abhiyan. We are doing several chunk of in things. We are also trying to think that how to not generate so much garbage. I mean, this is what the challenge is, collection and the other things. And we've done a lot of activities. We do consumer connect activities, sometimes for our clients also, sometimes for ourselves. We've seen that increasingly youngsters, when they come in, they're very conscious of it. They point it out. They sometimes ridicule us in case we have missed on to some area. You know, even, so for instance, our program requires a t-shirt to be distributed. Now that t-shirt was inside a polythene cover. You know, typically that's how most of the t-shirts come. And those were given at that time and somebody threw it. And then we saw kind of a very literally a huge discomfort being shown and expressed around that. So I think there is a consistent challenge or rather issues related with what is it which is getting consumed. And I think maybe that is a larger ecosystem across the globe wherein this communication is reaching them from multiple dimensions. Maybe we are not the only one who are able to communicate this to them, but there are several brands, several people, several audiovisual communication they are going to reaching, you know, reaching to them. So that is definitely extremely conscious thing. And also in the small towns, I mean, if it is in small towns, I would want to assume this is definitely there in the metro cities. But this one is a very big thing to be observed.
Okay. Just before you answer, I mean, even as a brand, would you rather then take on 15 causes or just take on one and then stick with it for 10 years? Right? Like as the government of India eradicated polio through radio and print predominantly at that point. So what is therefore the sense in terms of, so just to refine the question a little more because everyone has 2 minutes.
So one brand, one cause kind of a thing. That's a question.
So we are very focused since we are on the electrical side. So a very interesting example how we relate. So suppose this is a hotel, Taj is a hotel. One clearly is the consumption of electricity, which we talk from B2B perspective. But one of the hotel chains has a loyalty program. How can we do a sustainable thing from their loyalty program also, which gets an added benefit to a customer of Taj, but relates to the electricity and sustainable cause? So clearly our tagline becomes live the advantage. And live the advantage basically is sustainable, that whichever stakeholders is using Legrand, it gets that advantage from a sustainability perspective. But clearly you said it's one focus on the green earth where electricity is being consumed. So we don't look at multiple points. There are CSR programs as the other side, but clearly it's focused on one particular point of view.
You know, I'll just say that sustainability and community are two pillars of the brand. And we don't look at it as one or multiple programs. We actually do multiple programs in both these pillars. So one of the things, for example, that we do is all the coffee grounds are given to neighborhood areas for people to use for their trees. We give customers a certain rupee off if they get their own tumbler and they don't add to you know, the environment issue. We are also asking people in our stores not to take lids for cold beverages, saying that if you insist, we will certainly give it to you. But we have a campaign saying small steps. We think all of it needs to come together. We are working with persons with disabilities. We have a store in Parel which is run with 5 partners who have disabilities. We are one of the first companies to embrace gender parity, pay parity for women. So, and that's like a stated agenda. So we believe that whether our customers want it or no, it's a pillar at Starbucks, and we will always be at the forefront of two things, which is community and sustainability.
For us at MTV, it's more about influencing a mindset. So by that I mean, we want to try and instill a sense of, amongst young people, that people like us are doing things like these. So the insight that says we are action oriented, we need to magnify that. And to do that, taking one cause, I think, might be chewing off a bit too much. So we spread it across everything. So for example, last Dashera, we called out plastic as the new Ravan, and we did it in an interesting manner. We said, for every hateful troll comment that you send us online, we are going to clean 1 kilogram of plastic off the streets and beaches. And we pulled together the 1,000 tons and put up a plastic Ravan, which was to be recycled later. And in doing this, this activity itself will not cover all the youth of India, but it would reach a few million. Then you would do many more such activities where you're constantly trying to build a mindset amongst young people that people like us are behaving like this, they are taking actions like this. And that, I think, in the long run, the mindset shift will apply to multiple instances of sustainability and environment and so on.
At Wagh Bakri, we handle it at two different levels as such. One is at farm level, and secondly, as at, you know, when we blend our teas, we handle it that way. So as far as farm levels are concerned, you know, we go for the, you know, farms or tea gardens, which has got, you know, trust tea certificates. Now, trust tea certificates are only given to those tea gardens who believe in or who practice, you know, right farming practices as such, you know, they use right pesticides and in that too also in a proper measurements as such. So that is a trusty part, okay. And other thing is that in the company as such, you know, we have put up our own laboratory, which is, you know, very highly accredited laboratory, NABL certified laboratory, wherein we test our teas chemically also. So sometimes when we buy teas, from other estates wherein they do not have trustee certificates as such, so we chemically test it. So we, catch those, or we see to it that, those teas we reject, which has got, harmful pesticides. So in, the end effect is that the consumer gets, absolutely pure tea.
Rahul, before you answer this, I'm going to make it slightly different for us, because our perspective is slightly different. Is there a shift in briefs that are coming in saying that we want more purpose-led work rather than just whether it, and this is media agnostic. Our brands coming in saying, hey, listen, we want to actually do more purpose-led work, and that's a focus? Or is it still ki nahi mere ko ye cheez bechne ka 10 cheez aur fir ek bar main purpose kaam karega saal bhar mein? So what is the thing, or are the purpose briefs increasing?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question, and I was about to make that point, is that what the consumer, and whether we talk about the younger people, and I see this thing about that, okay, somebody, five people from my office are going for the NRA, the protest, and five more actually join. And brands starting to think that you can, there's a great opportunity. Activism seems to be the new engagement. But on the same time, I think that consumers, the younger audiences also sniff through it. That is there a strong brand connect? I know why you are picking on this piece vis-a-vis some other piece that you're picking on. I think that's where we as creators, we also need to be really, we need to be consistent. We need to answer your question. Yes, sometimes they do, but we always try and tell them that, just try and make it relevant. Just try and make it somewhere that you are coming two steps, and let the consumer also come two steps. And that's where it becomes a more purposeful thing. Just to cite an example, somewhere in the past, I had done something for Tata Power. They actually went to the most tier 2, tier 3 cities, and of course in metros as well, and they went to schools, and they only went and spoke to kids under within the fifth standard, like kids who are under standard fifth, and they went and told them that we have an entire contest around that whoever saves the maximum amount of electricity at house will become a part of the Geo Power Say campaign, the new jingle that Tata Power has. And I thought that was a fantastic example. To be very honest with you, that somewhere Tata Power was trying to get into retailing power and not. But when they went to kids, and that entire piece, it didn't seem through that entire exercise did not stink of strategy, to be honest. So I think yes, brands are become a little, the briefs are towards that, but somewhere I feel that they also need to see that it needs to be something which is more inclusive as a thing, and not that, okay, I'm picking this piece, so, and I believe that activism works, and therefore let's get this done.
Okay, this is the last question. I have a post-it that says that. So I'm going to make this slightly difficult to answer, speaking of inclusivity. What would be interesting is within your own competition of your individual brands, is there a piece of work, or is there a company that you look, an activity that a company did, or something that a company that you compete with did, that you sort of go like, hey, that's purpose that we could sort of ride with. And just in case you don't want to acknowledge your competitor, what I'm going to do is I'm going to leave it open a little bit more, saying that any other piece from any other brand that you guys sort of think is, hey, that's something that we should be looking at possibly going after. Competitor would be great though.
Yes. So competitor in the content space, yes. So at the FE's final round of judging, one of the cases that came to me was Alt Balaji, which is an app with content targeted mainly at women. And it was what you might call a low-cost idea, possibly entered in that category if I remember right, which was the fact that when you click on play for any video, usually when you're on the go, the video might tend to buffer. And you see that symbol which keeps going round and round. And what Alt Balaji did was they picked up that touch point and said, here is a touch point that millions of women are looking at day in and day out. And they created a small animated graphic which was for breast self-examination. And using that free touch point, by spending a total of 27,000 rupees, they managed to cover maybe 4 or 5 million women in 1 month and at least communicate to them the importance of breast self-examination. To me, it's a fabulous example of a very relevant piece of communication for women, which is much beyond what the brand needs to say, you know, about its content, and a fantastic innovation on a very low cost touch point. So something that I would love to acknowledge.
Grand Prix, you voted for?
Within our organization, there are 7 media brands, all compete with each other. And I think we envy each other.
Therefore, this is a cop out. Huh? This is smart.
No, but I genuinely appreciate something which one of the brands does, wherein they do something which is called Sanskar Shala. And this Sanskar Shala is for telling that there used to be a time wherein kids used to get moral education by default in all the schools, and I think our generation would have done it in our. But I think suddenly this morning prayers happening together or the assembly happening together is gone away because of the infrastructure and other issues. In the process, the moral education from the schools has completely gone away. Now, that one of the brands picked it up as a big issue and said that we want to take it to some, you know, 20,000 schools and we want to run it as an institutionally and support it in media. More important was that I was to sell certain things. So I went to this colleague of mine and I said that I think Patanjali is looking forward to something similar and would you let us sponsor this entire piece? So very politely and very humbly, he said, no, I would not let it do. I think this is something close to us. It'll remain there. Why am I saying this is that some, and I think we still keep struggling for getting some revenue for our own internal set of thing. But and this has genuinely been done for the last 8 years. This does not get promoted very extensively. This still happens with some 20,000 schools and this happens religiously. And I still personally believe this is the most important thing in schools besides all the academic excellences and the, you know, the digitization. But something like this, I think each of the brands should take up. And whichever brand takes up, Times Group does something phenomenally good in terms of education, newspaper in education. And I think nobody, you know, does it equivalent to them in this country. So that is the kind of work which I think should keep happening all across.
I'll probably talk about a company vision, which I really admire, by a woman I really admire, which is Indira Nooyi. And I think many years back, she kind of dared to say that performance and purpose can go together. For me, I think that was a big, very big level vision, which said that the two can go together and you can have success on the back of brilliant performance and purpose. That's something which has really inspired me.
Rahul, for you, Ogilvy worker.
I was about to say, I was trying to think. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, competitor for an advertising agency would be what. But just imagine if Fevicol could go and do a Chipko moment at RA. I don't know. They could. That would be wonderful, right? Let me just take the name of. I personally think that Earth Hour is a great initiative, guys. And I'm not saying that because they are here, Nat Geo is here, but I feel the simplicity of the action that that I could just switch off and let us all switch off at the same time. As creators, sometimes we also make a mistake of we make things way too complicated. It's the action. It's something that the entire world can look at, and it's just a small action we can make a great change. And I admire Earth Hour precisely for that piece. I think that's lovely.
For me, not a bigger cause, but I think to our target audience, the electricians. So very smartly, one of the company did a type of aggregator for the safety of the electricians, where the real life situations were coming posted by the electricians themselves. There was no guiding force. It's just that the electrician themselves were educating each other. It's a small thing, but I think it really helped up to where the electricians work and increase the safety part of it. Yes, very interesting.
Just you.
As far as competition is concerned, and say, you know, what they have done, something which is, we as a company admire what Organic India has done in UP. So it is, you know, farm to product, and they have bought, you know, change in, you know, farmer's life, which is something is worth admiring.
Okay, hope you guys had a great time. I've been sent 2 post-its now. So thank you so much. Thank you to all our panelists. Give them a round of applause. They've been fabulous and absolutely honest, which is a rarity in today's world. So thank you so much.